Well, good afternoon. It is my distinct pleasure to welcome you to the 2017 State of the Coast Guard Address presented by Admiral Paul Zukunft, 25th Commandant of the United States Coast Guard. Thank you for joining us today for this important event. I am Rear Admiral Jack Vogt, Director of Governmental and Public Affairs and the MC for this afternoon's presentation. If you have a cell phone, I ask that you please silence it now for the duration of the address. The State of the Coast Guard is an annual event that dates back to 1975. Today we have the privilege of welcoming you to the historic National Press Club. This beautiful ballroom has hosted heads of state and international leaders in industry and government for many years. I would first like to thank the Coast Guard Band Brass Quintet under the leadership of Senior Chief Musician Richard Denton for their performance here today. We also have many distinguished guests joining us. I am pleased to welcome His Excellency Eugene Newry, Ambassador of the Bahamas. His Excellency Emmanuel Gonzalez Revilla, Ambassador of Panama. His Excellency Harris Lalakos, Ambassador of Greece. His Excellency Selwyn Hart, Ambassador of Barbados. His Excellency Dang Tung Ham, Chief of Mission, Embassy of Vietnam. The Honorable Andres Montalvo, Deputy Chief of Mission, Ecuador. Ms. Ana Luisa Fayer, Charge d'Affaires ad Interim of Mexico. Deputy Secretary Chip Fulgham, Department of Homeland Security. Admiral Bob Papp, 24th Commandant of the United States Coast Guard. The Honorable William Brownfield, Department of State. Assistant Attorney General Kenneth Blanco, Department of Justice. Commodore Rick Washburn, National Commodore of the Coast Guard Auxiliary. And of course, Mrs. Fran Danino Zukunft, Coast Guard Ombudsman at Large. A special thank you is extended to the Navy League of the United States for their support of this year's address. And finally, a warm welcome is also extended to congressional staffers, military attaché officers, senior government officials, local community partners, industry representatives, members of our fellow armed services, Coast Guard retirees, and the women and men of the United States Coast Guard who are with us today. Master Chief Stephen Cantrell, the 12th Master Chief Petty Officer of the Coast Guard, will now introduce the Commandant. Please join me in welcoming Master Chief Cantrell.
Well, thank you and good afternoon, everyone. I hope you are all as excited as I am to be here today because 2016 was yet another banner year for our United States Coast Guard, and I am 100% confident that 2017 is going to be just as amazing. And why, you ask? Why? Because we continue to attract and recruit the most talented and dedicated Americans to serve this great country of ours as our nation's fifth armed service. We are repeatedly referred to as the world's best Coast Guard by senior government leaders. They could not be more right. Our people are conducting missions and operations around the globe and continue to inspire other countries to be like us. They say that imitation is the best form of flattery, and that's because our people and our missions shine throughout the world. I ask you all to be proud of our service and all that we represent. Whether it's the young seaman performing CPR on a small child and saving a life, or the hardworking bosun mate clearing the buoy deck on the lower Mississippi River, or the rescue swimmer dropping out of a helicopter into violent seas to pull a fisherman from the jaws of death, the talented helicopter pilot in that same aircraft that's maneuvering around hurricane force winds, and the thousands and thousands and thousands of other civilian, auxiliarist, active duty, and reserve members who come to work every day to make our country safer as we are a global force to be reckoned with. This, my friends, is your Coast Guard, and I'm confident that in my 34 years of service, it's never been stronger or more relevant to the United States of America. I'm extremely proud to serve alongside our Coast Guard men and women. Their talents, their dedication, and professionalism leave me inspired, but never surprised. And I love coming to work every day because of them. So to the men and women of our United States Coast Guard, thank you for your selfless service. And not to be forgotten, my wife Janet and I have the utmost respect and admiration for the families of our Coast Guard and all the support and love that you provide each other, our Coast Guard, and our nation. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for being here this afternoon. It is always an honor for me to introduce and welcome to the stage the 25th Commandant of your United States Coast Guard, Admiral Paul Zukunft.
First, I need to thank the Master Chief Petty Officer of the Coast Guard. Between he and I, we have been that steady hand on the tiller, not turning back when we see that wave crashing across the bow, but charging into it, as all good Coasties do, to grow our service. I want to thank everyone who is here today as well, from the Diplomatic Corps, senior leaders in every aspect, and especially what greater place to hold this than here at the National Press Club. The Coast Guard often finds itself serving in the shadows, and we need to put ourselves in the limelight. We need to put our men and women in the limelight as well, and so this is an ideal venue to showcase the wonderful things that our women and men do 24/7, 365 days, and we've been doing this since 1790. So let's kick this off. I'm going to kick it off with one word: phenomenal. It's a word you're going to hear several times during this 42nd State of the Coast Guard address. Phenomenal. And the reason you're going to hear this word several times, because it is the word General John Kelly used, our Secretary of Homeland Security, our Service Secretary, used to describe in front of Congress to describe the men and women of the United States Coast Guard just last month. Phenomenal. And I can think of no better word to describe our workforce, and I am truly humbled that our men and women do day in and day out. I could not be more grateful for each of our active duty, reserve, civil servant, and auxiliary members. This is a remarkable team, predisposed to put service before self. And serve they do, every day, as you saw in this film clip, to ensure the security and prosperity of this great nation. The Coast Guard is a unique instrument of national security. We are, first and foremost, an armed service. In fact, we are the only branch of the U.S. Armed Forces that has broad law enforcement authorities and a portfolio of more than 60 bilateral agreements that extend our jurisdiction around the globe. We secure our maritime borders thousands of miles before a threat reaches our homeland. We advance maritime commerce and economic security, and all in ways that no other service can. And it is all done by our phenomenal people. Now, to expand upon Secretary Kelly's characterization of our service, This has been a phenomenal year for our Coast Guard. Now let me just give you a list of the amazing things our Coast Guard men and women have done this past year. We awarded phase two to complete the build-out of our fleet of 58 fast response cutters at an affordable price. And the last four, numbers 19 through 22, were delivered by Bollinger Shipyards with zero discrepancies. We awarded the landmark acquisition for the first nine offshore patrol cutters to Eastern Shipbuilding Group, a down payment for our program of record of 25 of these very capable platforms that meet our requirements, and again, all at an affordable price. We awarded long lead time materials to Huntington Ingalls Shipyard for, yes, a ninth national security cutter. Now, as global threats emerge, this program of record has grown from 8 to 9 to meet that demand, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that later. We also stood up an integrated program office with our United States Navy and just recently awarded industry studies to accelerate the delivery and to commence the build-out of a fleet of 3 heavy and 3 medium icebreakers. Long, long overdue, and we are sprinting out of the starting blocks to deliver the first of this fleet, the first heavy icebreaker, by 2023. In the operational realm, working with CBP, ICE, DEA, the Departments of Justice, State, Defense, Treasury, the Director of National Intelligence, and all of our international allies, we achieved a record removal of 201 metric tons of cocaine this past year. That is nearly 500,000 pounds of cocaine, pure cocaine that did not make it to our shoreline, which used to be the annual consumption here in the United States. In addition, we brought 585 smugglers. These are members of transnational criminal organizations to justice here in the United States through extradition, where we have a nearly 100% prosecution rate, as compared to the less than 10% prosecution rate in their countries of origin. On its maiden voyage, our fourth national security cutter, aptly named the Coast Guard Cutter Hamilton, offloaded more than 26 metric tons of cocaine worth over $767 million on her maiden voyage. Again, the combined results of working in unison with our interagency and international partners. And today, the Coast Guard Cutter James is currently underway and is on track to have a similar success or perhaps even exceed that of the Hamilton, and again, on her maiden voyage. I don't know about you, but I cannot think of another asset in our entire U.S. inventory that more than pays for itself in less than 100 days. That's right, the value of cocaine that these assets remove in a single patrol is worth more than their initial acquisition cost. And these platforms are going to be around much longer than 100 days, in all likelihood, 4 decades. So again, what a great investment. Now, much of this would not be possible without our helicopter interdiction tactical squadron that we fondly call HITRON. In fact, it was just this past Friday that HITRON marked its 500th interdiction, using aviation use of force and precision disabling fire to finally level the playing field against this elusive fleet of go-fasts. And we have truly leveled the playing field in that regard. A true marriage between surface, air, and more importantly, intelligence. And is more proof that our intelligence-driven operations really pack quite a punch in this campaign against transnational criminal networks. Despite that success, there were 580 events where we didn't have enough aircraft, where we didn't have enough ships. We had the intelligence, but there were 580 events that got a free pass last year. It was an issue not of readiness, it was an issue of capacity. It was about ship numbers, which goes back to why do you need 9 and not 8 national security cutters? We need to level that playing field, and we're doing something about that as well. This administration and this Congress, they get it. As we recapitalize our legacy fleet across 3 cutter classes with ships that have proven to be a quantum leap over their predecessors, these are true game changers for the 21st century. Unfortunately, the flow of drugs towards our shores continue, and they increase. As more cocaine is being cultivated and produced in Colombia, the number one exporter of cocaine, more is being consumed by the number one consumer of cocaine. That would be our United States. And the Coast Guard and the United States writ large cannot defeat this threat of criminal networks alone. Just last week, I was the co-lead with Ambassador Brownfield as we met with our key and number one ally in this threat in Colombia. And we met with their president, President Santos, who is committed to stepping up to his nation's efforts to stamp out this shared threat, a threat to regional stability. This isn't just about cocaine bail numbers. This is impacting regional stability right here and right now. The irony of all of this movement is that we demand it. It spawns the violent crime in Central America, which therefore spawns migration, and so the cycle repeats itself. We've got to step up to the plate, and Colombia is doing that with us at our side. On another front, last year we apprehended over 5,000 Cuban migrants at sea, many of them going to desperate measures, shooting themselves, swallowing bleach, self-mutilation, so they could be medevaced to a U.S. hospital and become feet dry. Now, this has been our highest number of Cuban migrants that we have seen in a decade. Moving further north, we stood up, the Coast Guard stood up, the United States Coast Guard stood up, and we hosted the first Arctic Coast Guard Forum comprised of each of the 8 Arctic Consul nations. As the Arctic Consul does its work, who does the implementation of that? It's blank, but the Arctic Coast Guard Forum is there to answer this call. And this is a venue where I have an open dialogue, and I will have one a week from today in Boston when we host the next meeting of this forum with the 7 other Arctic Consul Coast Guards. What's important, this also includes my peer from the Russian Federation. It's imperative that we continue to have a dialogue with potential adversaries. If you sever communications, usually good things don't come out of that, and we can shape what is the future for the Arctic if we continue to have these dialogues, not just now, but into the future as well. And I look forward as we prepare to hand off the leadership of the Arctic Council and the Arctic Coast Guard Forum to Finland, as they will chair the Council and the Coast Guard Forum for the next 2 years. Now, this past year, we also created a cyber protection team. We received a clean financial audit opinion in 2016. The only armed service that can say that. But we did it in 2015, 14, and 13. I think we're a pretty good steward of public funding. A subject near and dear to me. The number of sexual assaults reports are trending downward. From 2014 to 2016, we have seen a 38% reduction in reports. And at the same time, we see an increased propensity for victims to file an unrestricted report that reflects trust in our network of victim advocates, special victims counsel, and a discreet and sensitive investigative process that upholds standards of accountability. One of my principles is, before I go there, we often talk about bystander intervention. And I'm going to change that lexicon because we are no longer a service of bystanders. We are by doers. We are by doers. If you saw the message that I put out to everybody in my email, I use that very same term, and we call it that on-scene initiative. We did it during Katrina. We do it day in and day out to save mariners in distress, but we are by doers. We are not standing at the side waiting to be told or think what the right thing to do is. So we must be by doers and commit ourselves to ridding our service of this scourge of sexual assault. We're down 38%. I want to see it go to zero. And going back to one of my guiding principles, duty to people. We are a service that lives this day in and day out. And on that note, we increased maternity leave this past year from 6 to 12 weeks. We doubled it. And I am consulting with the Department of Defense as we look at opportunities to expand leave for primary and secondary caregivers. And now, what organization would not be envious of our all-volunteer workforce of nearly 30,000? Our Coast Guard Auxiliary is truly the envy of the world. On an annual basis, they contribute over 4 million man-hours, 4 million man-hours in support of Coast Guard missions. And when it comes to economic prosperity of this great nation, perhaps the most overlooked aspect of our missions is the many hardworking men and women of our prevention team, marine inspectors, technical experts, and the maritime industry to ensure the security and safety of and to facilitate maritime commerce that again translates to economic prosperity and in turn national security. So make no mistake, we are a strategy-driven organization where intelligence drives operations to make best use of our very scarce resources. Now add to that a talented workforce, again with a propensity to put service before self, and you have a Coast Guard that offers tremendous returns on a relatively nominal investment. So I can state objectively and unequivocally, this has been a phenomenal year for our Coast Guard. So you might ask, so what is the state of today's Coast Guard? Well, let me tell you, we are the gold standard. That's right, we are the preeminent Coast Guard in the world. I can say that with conviction because I have visited with most of the Coast Guards around the world. Their paint schemes look eerily familiar, as do their uniforms. But what they can't replicate are the phenomenal men and women of the Coast Guard. For many years, we compared ourselves to the world's best Navy, and we never took credit and said, well, we're the world's best Coast Guard. And we have this great network of Coast Guards as well. And so as you listen to all of these successes, you might ask yourself, well, why don't you just sit back and write out the remainder of your term as Commandant of the Coast Guard? Not going to happen. Not going to happen. I am in the business of ensuring the readiness of our force. The hazards of our duty have not gotten any less hazardous. And I'm in the business of ensuring our men and women are properly trained and equipped to carry out their mission and ensure the security and prosperity of this great nation far into the 21st century and beyond. To a person, and me especially, we must be eternally vigilant. Let's face it, we live in a world that is not exactly breaking out in tranquility. We face the emergence of non-state actors and asymmetrical threats, transnational criminal organizations that generate over $750 billion each year from their illicit activities, which in turn erodes regional stability. We face the largest flow of refugees and migrants since World War II. We face human trafficking, piracy. We face illegal, unreported, unregulated fishing. What's important about this is that over 3 billion people today rely on fish as their primary source of protein, and a world population of $7.2 billion. The world's population is growing, and these fish stocks are shrinking. there again, a call for more Coast Guard. We face trafficking in drugs, weapons, bulk cash, all at a time when oceans are expanding as the Arctic sea ice retreats. Now, I shared this scene setter with more than 100 navies and Coast Guards this past September at the International Sea Power Symposium in Newport, Rhode Island. And at the conclusion of that, the whole tone of this symposium talked about more Coast Guard and the demand signal for the United States Coast Guard to engage on a global scale has never been greater because of these asymmetrical threats. And in fact, just 2 weeks ago, you would find the United States Coast Guard deployed off the coast of all seven continents. Six today because we just pulled back from Antarctica, the only military ship down there. We have always prided ourselves as a service that punches above our weight class. Yet, as our nation's fifth armed service, we are budgeted at the very bottom. The line items that we struggle to get on budget and fund are often considered as rounding errors by other branches within the federal government. So we still punch above our weight class, but to use this boxing metaphor, we are a service that is funded in the flyweight class. That is the lowest class, by the way, of the 16 boxing classes, if you follow boxing. So after 226 years of service, the time is long overdue to up our weight class, to at least the middleweight division. Our funding needs to reflect the power of our punch. Now, make no mistake, we are moving in the right direction. That's right, we are bulking up. The Coast Guard is recapitalizing at a pace that, quite frankly, has not been seen since the construction of 10 revenue cutters during the era of Alexander Hamilton. And I am immensely pleased with the pace that has been set in this recapitalization effort. But make no mistake, it is critical to our nation's security that we sustain this pace. And beyond this recapitalization, there are several critical cogs that must yet be machined to help us remain as the preeminent Coast Guard. More than $4.5 trillion of our nation's economic activity occurs on waterways on an annual basis, $4.5 trillion. Which all goes into discretionary spending, which goes into military spending. So it goes full cycle. But back to these waterways. These waterways are a critical part of our nation's infrastructure. They provide resiliency and at the same time relieve other modes of transportation. A case in point, just one tank barge takes the equivalent of 144 trucks off our already congested highways. A single common tow arrangement on our inland rivers removes more than 2,000 trucks from the road. Overall, I am talking about millions of trucks removed from our overstressed highway system. Now, these waterways, they're a maritime highway. They're maintained by our inland fleet of 35 cutters. 25 of these cutters are more than 50 years old, with the oldest being 73. Most of them are not configured for mixed gender crews. And many of them are being monitored for lead abasement and asbestos mitigation. So the time to replace this legacy, or some might call a geriatric class of cutters, has arrived. And it arrived a decade ago. Now, we face similar challenges with our shore infrastructure. Our infrastructure backlog currently exceeds $1.6 billion. Today, we are ostensibly making the interest payment on this backlog so we do not go deeper into the red. We depend on self-help projects like patching roofs and restoring utilities. And we are a service who are competing with the likes of Silicon Valley and others for the best talent across this land. And our ability to self-actualize, if you ascribe to Maslow's hierarchy of needs, is impeded when our men and women are diverted from focusing on operations and self-actualizing so that they can deal with line breaks, failed electrical systems, and leaking roofs. Yes, living at the very bottom of Maslow's pyramid, attending to basic shelter. And while it is refreshing to see this new generation of cutters arrive on the waterfront, we, the Coast Guard, the Department of Defense, Department of Homeland Security, collectively lack enough eyes in the sky. We simply do not have enough surveillance platforms to track and complement our squadron of manned aircraft currently staged on foreign soil to interdict threats before they reach our homeland. So what I'm talking about is the Coast Guard absolutely must acquire land-based, unmanned, or remotely piloted systems in a very meaningful way. And then there's our information technology backbone. We are far from state-of-the-art. In fact, our IT infrastructure is in need of recapitalization as well. We need to overcome the fiscal challenges of migrating to Microsoft Windows 10. It's mission critical, and it is very critical in reducing our cyber vulnerabilities. And on the topic of fiscal challenges, some may believe, well, those woes are behind you, as increases in military spending grow ever more promising. But there's a single phrase that has boxed in the Coast Guard, that has attributed to our annualized operating and maintenance appropriation being funded well below the Budget Control Act floor for each of the past 5 years. You might ask, what is that phrase? And that phrase is non-defense discretionary spending. We must invest to restore our military readiness, our capability, our capacity. The Coast Guard is an armed service, yet we are not postured to benefit from vital national security investments because our funding is classified incorrectly. Our women and men are military members who operate on the front lines to secure our nation and our borders. Yes, we are in the business of national security. At home and abroad, our service must be categorized and funded accordingly from this point and well into the future. As I said before, we are a service that punches above our weight class. We need to move up. Our funding needs to reflect the power of this punch, and we need to begin with restoring the 1,100 reserve billets that were cut due to sequestration and offsets. We need to retain our civil servant workforce. Each one of them are integral to our mission execution and our mission support. On the uniform side, we need to grow our active duty component by 5,000 people in the next 5 years. And to the men and women of the Coast Guard, active, reserve, civil servant auxiliary, those standing the watch on shores near and far, to the myriad indispensable specialties that we kept, that you apply to the mission every day to ensure our national security and prosperity, and let's not forget our military families. To a person, you have been phenomenal, and you are the backbone of what has made this such a tremendous year for our service. It is your heavy lifting at the deck plates of this organization across every community, your heavy lifting that has uplifted our United States Coast Guard. So I close by saying, prepare to lace up your gloves and get in that ring as the middleweight contenders that define our punching power. We no longer live in a world for flyweights. So God bless our Coast Guard and these United States of America. Thank you, and semper paratus.
Well, thank you, Admiral Zukunft. And thank all of you for your attendance today. This concludes the 2017 State of the Coast Guard Address. Coast Guard Headquarters employees returning to St. Elizabeth's, the shuttle buses are reminded to promptly make their way to the pickup location on 14th Street. Please look for your bus marshal to identify your ride back. Guides are waiting at the exit to direct you. And again, thanks to all of our guests for joining us for today's State of the Coast Guard Address. Thank you.